Russ Metty was probably one of the most eclectic cinematographers in his style all the way through his career. He worked with so many different directors and so many kind of signature directors like Douglas Sirk and John Huston and Anthony Mann, Bud Bedeker. His style, I think, served not just the material, but also the particular idiosyncrasies of the director. So it's hard to really lock into one style, except for the films that he did with Douglas Sirk during the 1950s with very dramatic, colorful light. And of course, his long experience with Orson Welles, having photographed The Stranger and Touch of Evil, both extremely strong noir stylistic films. And his experience with Welles, of course, goes back even further. He supposedly did some of the tests, early tests, on Citizen Kane and some additional scenes on the reshoots of Magnificent Ambersons.
I say, just a minute. I beg your pardon. Oh, dear.
You shouldn't do that, you know.
But what shouldn't I do?
Talk while someone's shooting.
Yes,
well, anyway, I forgive you because I got a good shot. But you
don't. One of his early features, bringing up Baby, such a fast-paced, crazy comedy that it's hard to actually think about the filmmaking, the style in it. Russ Metty was known for more controlled compositions, really controlled lighting. The compositions, of course, are serviceable, and they're set according to image size to what you need to see in the frame, especially the physical gags. But even allowing for that, there's a lot of imagination in it, in several sequences especially. The scene in the Ritz nightclub is actually my favorite scene in the whole movie.
May I check your hat, sir?
Excuse me?
Check your hat.
Oh, no, I better... Well, maybe you...
It's absolutely fascinating. From the time that Cary Grant walks into the club and there's the whole incident with the hat check girls, and the use of the camera was very imaginative in terms of dolly shots that brought you from one part of the action to the next part, as opposed to a lot of cutting. The shot selection is very, very minimal. It's mainly wider shots where you can see all the characters. So the action reaction within the shot is there, and you can scan the frame in a sense and not have to cut to somebody's reaction.
Well, my name's Susan Vance.
I'm Dr. Fritz Lynn.
Oh, well, that's all right. You can sit down. I don't mind
Thank
at all.
You.
Cuts, especially in comedy, always slow things down. And they always act as indicators, as signal, how the filmmaker thinks the viewer, the audience, should react. And that's a mixed bag. Sometimes you can control it. But I always feel it's better in comedy when you can let the actors create the moment.
Well, there it is.
Yeah.
Thank you, babe.
Well, thank
very
you,
kind
sir.
Of you.
Very kind.
Well, no. This is my purse, my diamond pin it is.
All right,
will you please give that?
Oh,
no, no, I'm
give me that.
No, will you please hand it
please
over?
Do something
will you
about
please
it?
Keep
will
out of it, darling?
Go ahead, do something
very
about
clumsily.
It.
And it's up to you, the viewer, to sort of create the moment of humor or absurdity among the actors.
The gardener must have clothes, clothes are clothes.
Not in his house.
Well, he couldn't have taken all his clothes with him.
I think our cinematic eye, or as viewer, has become so flattened or so addicted to sensation. The cuts are so short. And it essentially, it reduces you to somebody that is just experiencing light and sound and movement, abrupt, quick movement. And so you go back and you look at, you know, classic Hollywood films of the 30s and 40s, especially a film like Bringing Up Baby. And it's very satisfying because you kind of feel you're participating in the scene, because you're just off camera watching it, as opposed to being assaulted by the cuts and the frenetic movement.
Hello? Oh, it's you.
Even when there are cuts, the cuts for the most part are a slight change of angle. But it's essentially the same image size, just altering the space. Or you cut to a two shot and then back to the master again.
What do you say?
Oh, it's too late. It was the night watchman. He said, everybody's gone. They're all out leopard hunting.
Oh,
master shot, when we often think of them, are just to establish the space. You don't even think of them as a master because there's so much happening in the frame. The fact of the matter is, in Bringing Up Baby, most of the film is in three-quarter shots and two shots, very few close-ups.
Oh, don't do that, Susan. Don't go near the door.
No, but
oh, dear, dear, dear.
The close-ups, the single shots that are in Bringing Up Baby, are very quick. I don't want to say they're arbitrary, but they may be functional just to kind of break the space. And I think you really notice it in another sequence that I like a lot, the whole jail sequence where they're behind bars, and it's when she decides to come out and play the gun mall.
Swinging door, Susie hasn't clapped yet. I'm out this far, ain't I? Well, so long, gang. I'm not taking the rap for this job. It's every man for himself.
The swinging door, Susie. And they go into Slocum's office, and she sits in the windowsill, and you have, I think, four or five characters there. And it's minimal coverage, one wide shot to another wide shot. Part of it seems really kind of loosey-goosey, improvisatory. It almost looks like a stage set. It's almost a little uncomfortably wide, but there are times when everybody's got to be in the shot. And to try to see the requisite chaos that is demanded by the action in that scene and an attempt to try to bring it into some sort of visual order is really interesting. One of the great things that Metty was able to do, even though he wasn't working in a highly dramatic mode like film noir, he was able to create a sense of depth with the characters.
Will you please stop doing that with your hat?
Well, just stand there, will you?
You notice that the back walls are not flatly lit, and the actors are lit just a little bit brighter, you know, so they stand out, and there's a sense of depth that is very subtle, but which is different than what you think of when you think of just high-key comedy where the light is just pumped in from the front. And Russell Metty was really good at that from the very beginning, and that kind of nuanced lighting became very much his style, reaching its kind of zenith with Orson Welles and then with Douglas Sirk. People tend to think that comedy does have certain rules. I mean, certainly musical comedy does. But for a lot of comedy, especially contemporary comedy, I don't think a lot of what we perceive as those rules of being wide, static camera, you know, high key or flat lighting, I don't think they apply. A lot of American comedic films are very dialogue-based, either verbal jokes, word plays, or in the case of the screwball comedies, a lot of overlapping, misunderstood dialogue. The European directors like Pierre Tex and Jacques Tati really rely much more on the image to create the comedy rather than the dialogue. American studio comedies in the 30s were either derived from Broadway comedies or written as original screenplays by New York Broadway writers. And that's why when you see somebody say like Lubitsch or Howard Hawks essentially bring a kind of visual panache and still keep the dialogue fresh and sparkling, that's what I think of as kind of the golden age of American film comedy. Russ Metty had a really distinguished career and was highly regarded by his contemporaries, even though he worked for the studio that was not the most highly regarded studio, Universal. He stayed there for many, many years and had a huge number of assignments, and he was doing 5 and 6 films a year. But there was another Metty that also was very comfortable with technology. The January 1961 issue of American Cinematographer magazine is devoted to new technology, and there's a section in there where Herb Lightman, who was the editor at the time, talks about the photography of Spartacus and Metty's work. When Anthony Mann was replaced on Spartacus very early on, and Metty stayed, Kubrick basically told him, just stay out of my way, sit in your chair, and don't do anything. And that's the kind of myth that has been sustained over the years because Kubrick is seen as the consummate auteur. I think the truth is something else. I mean, it was 167 days of shooting. It was done in a very complicated technique called Super Technorama 70, and the camera most of the time was on a huge Chapman crane. It was a Titan crane, which goes not 29 feet in the air, and it was modified to go 35 feet on the extension. And I just don't think Kubrick was riding around on that crane all day long. and he certainly wasn't operating that camera. Even though I never personally met Russ Metty, I would see him around the lot. And I was a very young sort of day-playing camera operator on TV series. And he was kind of a mythical character even then. Of all the Hollywood cinematographers I can think of, and especially the ones under contract during the, 30s and 40s and early 50s, nobody had the wide spectrum of credits on different kinds of movies that Russell Metty had.
Susan, is there any way to cross this stream?
Oh, surely it's shallow. We can wade across.
Oh, good.